Welcome to Lincoln Hills Community Church live and online. And if you're joining us today, if you're just down the street or if you're in a different city or a state, if you're in our sanctuary, well, we want to make sure that you feel that you're part of the church because, well, that's the way we feel. And we are glad that you joined us together because we believe that we are better together than we could ever be alone. I want to remind you that you are in our prayers, so keep us in your prayers as well. For everyone in the congregation, isn't it nice to hear that organ live? Amen? Amen? Thank you, Jim. Psalm 104, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. Today we are in the house of the Lord so that we may worship our God. Amen? The flowers that are on display today are in celebration of Mary, Joe, and Fred Garrison's 9th anniversary this week. But we also want to remember some other. Bill and Stephanie Padovona are celebrating 50 years of marriage this week. And Jim and Sherry Hunter are celebrating 61 years of being married this week. And of course, we know that anybody who's been married for 61 years knows the four most important words of a marriage. Yes, dear. Knows the four most important words in a marriage. I'll do the dishes. And so, as a church, we want to help these couples celebrate their anniversaries. God bless you all. It's been 6 months since we've stopped meeting together, but we are slowly coming out of our hibernation. And to keep you up to date on our progress of the events in and around the church, we send out the bulletin that if you're not able to be here, that you can still look on the email and see the bulletin and see all the things that are continuing to go on here at Lincoln Hills Community Church. We're not doing the black attendance folders, so we're asking everyone here to fill out that little yellow slip and put it in the basket as you leave today. And I want to make sure that you understand that their ministries are alive and well. Our food drive is starting this week, going till the 24th. And so there'll be a table outside Monday through Thursday. We also let you know that the Women of the Word Bible Study Group will be meeting Monday morning at 9:30 here in our sanctuary. It's an informal session to share some of our recent experiences and to hear from the Word of God. And this Wednesday from 10 a.m. to 12, the Women's Ministry Journey for Jesus drive-through. Women in the church have probably received a notification in the mail. You've probably received a phone call. There's information in your bulletin. Lord knows we even sent out a smoke signal. You may have seen that. So it's this week in Wednesday from 10 a.m. to noon. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us and call us your children. We thank you for the blessings that we've seen today and the hope that we have for tomorrow in Jesus Christ. We would ask that your Spirit would fill this sanctuary, that your Spirit would fill the homes and the offices of the men and women watching your service. We pray your blessing upon our musicians and our singers, our technicians and our volunteers. We pray your special blessing upon Pastor as he brings your message today. And we ask all these things in Jesus' most precious, most personal name. Amen. Our call to worship today is Onward Christian Soldiers. And you are invited to sing as long as you keep your mask on. And then we have Jim and Gloria, Jan and Gail to help us out. Onward Christian Soldiers. Can I just tell the congregation, that was wonderful. Isn't it nice to be in God's house and singing his praises? Today's responsive reading is the Ministry of Angels. Tricia was going to be here with me, but she couldn't make it today. And so I'll be reading the first part. And if you can, please read along with me on the second part. The Ministry of Angels. I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. And above him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands, 10,000s times 10,000. And they encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they sang, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation? For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways, and he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. And the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them." And now let's sing again, "Rise Up, O Church of God."
Church of God, his kingdom tarries long. Bring in the day of brotherhood and end the night of wrong. Rise up, O sons of God, the church for you doth wait. Her strength unequal to her task, rise up.
We'd like to remember Carla LaFave today. Next Friday, she'll be having surgery to remove those painful kidney stones. And until then, we will pray for freedom from pain. And then we'll pray for wisdom and skill for the doctors. James 5:13 tells us, "Is any among you suffering? Let him pray. Is any among you cheerful? Let him sing songs of praise." And I believe that each one of us knows someone in our family, in our neighborhood, in church, that could use a prayer. And so I'm going to ask you to take just a few moments and pray for that person. Bring them before the altar of God. And then after a few moments, allow me to pray for all of us. Heavenly Father, we would ask that you would remember those that we have brought before your throne this morning. We would pray that you would take watch care over our families, over our church, and over our country at this most difficult time. And Lord, we would ask for your great hand in dealing with these wildfires up and down the West Coast. We pray for the safety of your children as they have to evacuate. Heavenly Father, we pray for the protection of their homes. We pray for the protection of the brave firefighters who willingly put themselves in the line of danger for others. Protect them, Lord. And we would tell you thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We would tell you thank you for your Holy Spirit who moves our feet to your service. We ask that you would grant our prayers for the glory of your name as we recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Sky shall unfold, preparing his entrance. The star shall applaud. Sweet light in his eyes shall enhance those awaiting, and we shall.
Slumbering place. I thought you were getting ready for me to sing or something. Miracles still happen. Hey, it is great to see you all out here today. My, oh my. And every week, every day, it seems like we have to think on our feet and adjust our plans and everything. And I was all ready. We were ready to have it outside because it went so well last week. And Rod and Larry did such a great job setting it up out there. So we were going to meet outside. We may yet do it again. Depends on what all this smoke is doing. But God had other ideas. So we were able, unfortunately this week they gave us the, you know, the green light about being able to meet again up to 100 people inside. So that worked out well for us, and it's so great to see all of you here this morning. This morning what I want to do is begin a series that a lot of you have been asking me to do on angels. And I did that several years ago, and it was really, people just were fascinated, wanted to look into the Word of God about the ministry of angels. So that's what we're going to do over the next few weeks. And I want to begin by reading a little story to you. All of you are familiar with Corrie Ten Boom, The Hiding Place, probably. She and her family hid Jewish people in Holland during World War II. And they'd been doing it for several years. And then in June of 1944, someone in the neighborhood went to the authorities and the Gestapo came and arrested the family. Now, the truly amazing thing, I didn't realize this until I was reading about it, 30 Jewish people that they had upstairs in a hiding place, they never did get them. They took the family. But those 30 people then were able to get out of there and survive the war. But Corrie and her sister, Betsy is the one on the left there and Corrie's on the right. Corrie was the youngest, Betsy was the oldest, and they were shipped off to Ravensbrück concentration camp. Their father died in another concentration camp not long after he was taken captive, and Betsy also died there in Ravensbrück. But Corrie writes about that whole episode when they first were taken to the camp, and I want to read to you what she tells you about it, because it just highlights the ministry of angels. She said, when we first went in there, we had to discard all of our clothing and take showers and get cleaned, supposedly getting rid of the lice and everything else. And I told my sister, Betsy, he said, give me your underwear. They'll take it away from us. Give it to me. I'm going to hide it along with my Bible. And so she did. She bundled it up and put it over in the corner. And then when they got out of the shower, they went back and they took the underwear. She says, I took mine and my Bible, and I hid it under my dress. And as we were going out, the guards are checking everybody. And I prayed, and I told Betsy, God is going to take care of us. He's going to help me get through. His angels are going to protect us. And I prayed, Lord, please have your angels surround me. Don't let them see anything. Make me transparent today. So as they went out, a lady in front of them, they caught her. Then I went through, they didn't even see me, didn't even stop me, just went right on through. It was like angels just totally shielded me. And then when Betsy came through, they checked her out. Well, then we get to the front door, and there are more guards just outside, women guards. They're checking us out again. Same thing. I literally walked right by them. It was as if God's angels were making me totally transparent. But the ministry of angels, is as I walked out of there, I had this jubilant cry in my heart. I said, oh Lord, if thou dost so answer my prayers, I can face even Ravensbrück concentration camp unafraid. God's angels, they have a ministry to us, and I want to talk about them with you today. There's a lot of interest in angels today. Hebrews 1:14, of course, tells us that ministering spirits, they're sent to serve those who will inherit salvation. And it also reminds us, brothers, practice brotherly love. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. And of course, I think the writer is thinking back to that time when Abraham entertained the angel of the Lord and two other angels with him when they were in Lot. But God reminds us that there are times when angels do show up in our lives. You go to any store today and you can find all kinds of books on angels. Solomon, a long time ago in Ecclesiastes, said, of the making of many books, there just seems no end. You can find books, Angels 101, you find another one, Angels in My Hair. Now, that doesn't apply to me because there's nothing to be there. More books on angels. I mean, some of it gets kind of racy. This one on that just up there is, I won't go into it, but the crazy books. And you can buy every little trinket imaginable out there on angels. But 1 Timothy 4:7, Paul writes this, have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. And there are a lot of those out there today. A couple of books that I would recommend to you, and some of you probably have read them. Billy Graham, several years ago, came out with a book on angels, very good. And David Jeremiah has another book on angels. Those are good books. If you wanted to read a little bit more on what the Bible says about angels, those would be very good for you. Why all the interest in angels? Well, let me tell you several reasons. One is this postmodern disillusionment with any kind of thing today, science, government, education. It's a distrust of any kind of academic or governmental or power institutions. People fear. They fear disasters, economy, war, diseases. They're looking for answers, and they're searching them on the transcendent. The material right here just isn't giving the answers, so they're looking for, whether it's God, it's angels, whatever. Supernatural answers for desperate times. Let me read a couple things to you. Peter Greift, who's professor of philosophy at Boston College, writes, these are desperate times and people are searching for supernatural solutions to their problems. Problem is, they're looking for the wrong things. There's three critical mistakes when we talk about angels, and this is what we need to keep in mind as we get into the study. Number one, we start viewing angels like little cherubic beings, you know, little fat Gerber baby, you know, that kind of thing. The other one is to let angels begin to replace God by literally creating a bite-sized version of God. That's what people do with angels. They start praying to the angels, and boy, you want to be careful on that one. And then the other one is this, and this is what Christians often do. They ignore and they deny that ministry. So on the one hand, you don't want to turn them into gods themselves, but the second thing is you don't want to ignore them because they are real and they do have a purpose in our lives. Here are the reasons they're important. Angels are referred to in 34 of 66 books in the Bible. They're mentioned in the Old Testament, 17 of the books and 17 of the New Testament books. The word angel occurs over 300 times in Scripture. But there are other words like cherubim, seraphim, archangels, sons of God, principalities and powers, and there are actually a few more. They're mentioned all over the place in the Bible. So we shouldn't ignore them. But as we look at angels and we get into study, we study to show ourselves approved unto God, rightly dividing the word of truth. So let's make sure we understand what the Bible says and what it doesn't say. So let's talk about this. The first thing that I want to do with you is talk about what is the relationship of Jesus and the angels. Number one, Jesus said that they ministered to his needs. The Bible says angels minister to his needs. Let's look at a scripture. When Jesus was tempted by the devil in the wilderness at the outset of his ministry, it says at the conclusion of it, after the devil had left him, it says, then the devil left him and angels came and attended. It's literally ministered to him. What does that mean? I don't know. But they cared about their master and they ministered to his needs. Some of his needs in that moment would have been hunger and thirst because he had been fasting for 40 days. He had just been through an intense temptation time with the devil. Angels strengthened Jesus through his trials also. In Gethsemane, remember when he prayed, Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but your will be done. And then it says this, and an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. What was that strengthening? I don't know. It may have been that one of the heavenly hosts came along and just said, Lord, you know, you're right. And you're going to be okay, and whatever it may have been. But they strengthened him. And also, angels rejoiced at his birth. We know that. That's what Christmas is all about. Can you believe Christmas is not that far away? My, they've already got Halloween out there at Costco. Next month, it'll be Christmas. Well, suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel praising God and saying, say it with me, glory to God in the highest. Amen. Yes, indeed. Angels are also fascinated with the gospel. I got to share this with you. This is an amazing statement in 1 Peter. You know, the angels didn't understand it all about the gospel, and they really wanted to know about the gospel. Here's what it says in 1 Peter. I'm going to go back up and read verse 10 and then down to 12. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who spoke of the grace that was to come to you, they searched intently and with the greatest of care. Even the prophets didn't totally have the big picture, but they knew they were presenting and prophesying things that had to do with the grace of God. They were trying to find out the time and the circumstances to which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointed when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves but you when they spoke of the things that have now been told to you who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Even angels long to look into these things. Prophets had a hard enough time trying to understand. The angels really wanted to understand this. I don't know about you. That just excites me. I like the way the Message Bible puts it. Do you realize how fortunate you are? Angels would have given anything to be in on this. So, you know, they didn't get it all. And it's certainly that day when Jesus was born, God is saying, okay, now it begins. Go and announce to them. And they did. Well, what else do we learn? Angels, and this is very important for us, angels are subordinate to Jesus Christ. That's the great problem with a lot of New Age stuff, some of the Gnostic stuff that was in that second century. They elevate angels above Jesus. That's wrong. It's not biblical. Listen to this. The Son is the radiance. It's talking about the writer of the Hebrews is writing this Jewish Christians who are thinking about abandoning their faith. He says, listen, the Son, Jesus Christ, he's the radiance of God's glory. And the exact representation, the word exact representation there is literally a word. It could be like a photograph. Do you remember what Jesus said? He who has seen me has seen the Father. He's the exact representation of his being. He sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. So he became much superior to the angels, as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. Then he goes on, he says this, for to which of the angels did God ever say, you're my son, today I've become your father, or again, I will be his father and he will be my son. Never said that to any of the angels. And again, when God brings his firstborn into the world, he says, let all the angels worship him. In weeks ahead, we're going to look at that, because they teach us something about worshiping. Therefore, Philippians, and I know you know this passage, therefore God exalted him, Jesus, to the highest place and gave him a name that's above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Somebody once said that someday when Jesus reigns and comes, and in the judgment, the devil's going to have bloody knees. You know why? Because all the saints are going to be forcing him down. Get on your knees. Get on your knees. He's an angel. He's going to have to bow. Yes, indeed. Jesus is superior to all the angels. And then, of course, the angels worship Jesus. Revelation, it says, then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels. A loud voice they sang, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. I am the Lord. That's my name. I'll not give my glory to another, not to an angel, to anyone. And angels understand that. Okay, let's talk about what Jesus said about angels. He told us that angels will be with him when he returns. You know, that day is going to be something when Jesus returns. And I also believe he's going to bring all the resurrected saints with him too, because the Bible says that. But man, what a massive invasion that's going to be. For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels. And then he will reward each person according to what he has done. It also tells us angels will purge his kingdom of evil. The Son of Man, this is in Matthew 13, Jesus said, the Son of Man will send out his angels and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. It also goes on to say, this is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. So angels are going to be weeding out the evil at the end. Angels also protect him. He said in the Garden of Gethsemane, you remember this, do you think I cannot call my father? Peter's whipping out his sword. He's going to fight for Jesus. He says, put the sword away. I don't need it. I can call more than 12 legions of angels. What is a legion? One Roman legion with 6,000 soldiers. 12 times 6,000, you do the math. That's 72,000. That's just a small portion, you'll see in a minute. The devil understood this too. At the end, when he's tempting Jesus in the at that temptation, he says, look, he takes him up to a high mount and the temple and says, just throw yourself down, the angels, it's written. He will command his angels concerning you and they'll lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against the stone. That really was a scripture written for us. But the devil is saying, see, you don't do that. God will take care of you. And what did Jesus say? It's written, you will not tempt the Lord your God. Jesus is telling him, don't pull that on me. But he also goes on to say, angels rejoice at salvation of sinners. I wonder what it was like when you were saved. What kind of rejoicing went on in heaven? What they said. What's he say? I tell you, there's rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. And angels also, this is what everybody always wants to know a little bit about, they have special care over children. Does each child have a guardian angel? Well, it never quite says that. But it does say this. Jesus said, you see these little children, don't look down on them. For I tell you that the angels in heaven always see, notice it says, their angels in heaven, always see the face of my Father in heaven. What it does tell me is that angels have special concern, special care for little children. Well, how many are there? This is really a pretty amazing thing. Jesus already mentioned in Mark 5, you know, that or at Gethsemane, that I can call 12 legions. When Jesus cast out the demon out of this demoniac in Mark 5, Jesus asked him, what's your name? And he says, my name is Legion. There were literally 6,000 demons inside this man. Jesus said, at my disposal, I can have 12 legions. We mentioned that. In Psalm 68, he's describing the scene in heaven. He refers to angels as chariots of God, thousands of thousands. What's a thousand of thousands? That's a million. Then in Hebrews 12:22, again, it says, heavenly Jerusalem will come upon thousands, but it's more than a million. I heard the voice of 100 million, Revelation 5:1. Here's what it said. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. You know, how good are you in your arithmetic? 10,000 times 10,000, that's 100,000 angels. And that's not all of them. He says the same thing in Daniel. A river of fire was flowing, coming from before him. Thousands upon thousands attended him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. I can't imagine what that would be like. I was watching a football game the other night, and they had 17,000 people in a stadium that would hold 77,000 people, and looked pretty empty. Can you imagine what that's going to be like in heaven? Can you imagine looking at 100 million people, angels? That doesn't count all the saints. Wow, heaven's going to be big. Well, we're almost to the end here. Do angels die? Well, yes and no. Here's what it says in Luke chapter 20. But those who are considered worthy of the resurrection from the dead will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They can no longer die. Why? For they're like the angels. Angels don't die. However, they do die, some of them, the ultimate death. Revelation, this is what it says. Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Matthew 25. Then he goes on to say this in the 20th chapter of Revelation. And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire. There will be an ultimate eternal death for Satan and for his angelic hosts, which are the demons. So, yes and no. The angels that serve the Lord and guard you and me, they don't die. We'll be like them. We'll be better than angels, but we'll be like them in that sense when we're in heaven. But as for Satan and his ultimate destiny and those who serve him, the lake of fire, eternal death. Lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. And then that kind of addresses us. Each one of us want to make sure our name is written in that book of life. Because there is an eternal destiny for people who have not embraced Jesus Christ. Who have not given rise to the angels rejoicing because we've embraced Jesus. Here's what it says to us in Romans 10:13. Whoever will call upon the name of the Lord, they will be saved. There's no lake of fire. Hey, there's no smoke there, is there? Wow. I've been asking myself the last few days, Lord, why all this stuff? I don't know, maybe he's trying to give us a hint. But all who call on the name of the Lord, they will be with the Lord in glory. And you know what? It's going to be a welcome home. I hope you're looking forward to that. Not going to be any fire. There's not going to be any smoke. Not going to be any death. Not going to be any sorrow. Not going to be any illness. No tears whatsoever. You know, as we talk about the angels, I think it's so important that we wind this thing down and relate it to us in our own lives and where we're at. I know most of you sitting out there today, and I hope most of you out there sitting, listening, you've made that commitment to Jesus Christ. And if you've done that, then the Bible says nothing is going to take you away from the love of God that's in Jesus Christ. But I want you to be sure of that. And each one of us want to make sure that we have given to the Lord what he will keep. As Paul said, I'm persuaded that he's able to keep that which I committed to him against that day. What's it going to be like? John says in 1 John chapter 3, it's not appeared to us what we're going to be like, but when he appears, we will see him as he is and we'll be like him. And Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me will never die. Yeah. They'll bury you, they'll cremate you, whatever. But you will never die. Absent of the body, you're now at home of the Lord. But there's something even better I've got for you, a resurrection. And he that liveth and believeth in me will absolutely never die. That's what we look forward to. Don't look forward to the lake of fire. I look forward to welcome home, good and faithful servant. There's a song I want you to close with me today. It's a song, Just As I Am. And I don't mean that you got to get out of your seat and come up here today. This is a great Billy Graham song that used to be at all the conferences. But I want you to listen to the words. And I want you to think of the grace of God. You know, we say, how can I be worthy of the kingdom? How can I be worthy of standing with Jesus? Listen to the words. Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. He just says, just come as you are. You don't have to get it all cleaned up. Just come with a heart that says, I believe. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears, within and without, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, and cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. This morning as we sing that, with your heart, come before him and praise him that he does receive you. And we look forward to that day when he embraces us and he says, welcome home. Let's stand. Let's sing that song together. sing that last verse in just a moment, but maybe somebody out there sitting at home listening to this today, and you're saying, oh, but how can I come? How can I be what he would accept? Listen, my friend, Jesus simply says, you come to me. All of you that are burdened, come to me and I'll give you rest. I'll not cast you out. You know what the Bible says? If you believe in your heart and confess him with your mouth, you will be saved. Believe that he died for your sins. Believe that God triumphed over death by raising Jesus. And that's what he wants to do for you. He doesn't say you got to clean up your act. The Holy Spirit will start to take care of that in your life. But what you do have to do is make your heart willing to reach out to me. If you reach out to him, he'll reach out to you. I can promise you that. So if you're home today, that's never happened for you. Just as we close and read sing the last words of this song, just as I am, you will receive, you'll welcome, I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. I pray that for you today. Let's sing that last verse.
Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promises I believe, O Lamb of God.
It's been great to see you all there today. And those of you who are watching at home, God bless you. It's so good to have that congregation out there too. And next week we'll see what it's like outside. I would love to meet outside if the weather's decent. How did you like that last week? Did that work for you? We'll do that. I mean, and we'll still do it at 9 o'clock and kind of keep you from the heat, although I think it's going to start to be better. But just tune in. Read your email. We'll send something out to you to make sure you know whether we're inside, outside, but we'll be here at 9 o'clock one way or the other. Oh, it's a thrill for me to see you all today. And when we finish here, keep your mask on. I know, I wish I could tell you, try to keep 6 feet apart. I know some of you want to just touch elbows and things, but we still try to distance it the best we can and just practice some good, whatever they tell us to do. It's great to see you. I'm going to ask Rich Kauser, one of our elders, to come. Rich, you come and lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this day, the opportunity to fellowship together. Thank you for the message we received this morning about angels. And there are some here that have experienced an event that quite possibly an angel was involved. I know in my family we have, and we are blessed. I would like to ask that we all pray for our first responders, firemen, as the pastor was saying, that are fighting these terrible fires and creating the smoke, our police officers that are trying to bring order and safety to our communities. And the hard one, Lord, is pray for our president and all of our senators and congressmen. And please bring them together, Lord. Let them work together and not worry about who gets elected, but what is best for our country. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.